Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the final talk, which was organized as part of the quantum communications workshop, which is organized by the IEEE IISc Communication Society with partnership with IndiCue community. So for the final talk, we have a very special guest with us today, Dr. Tirtha Pratimda. Dr. Tirtha Pratimda is the director of the science program office, ISRO headquarters, Bangalore, India. A trained planetary scientist, Dr. Da started his career in ISRO as a launch vehicle technologist in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, ISRO, and contributed to the PSLV and GSLV missions. Subsequently, he played a significant role in the planetary exploration program of ISRO and contributed to the scientific exploration of Moon and the Mars in Chandrayaan 1 and 2 and Mars orbiter missions. In the pursuit of disruptive technologies in ISRO, Dr. Da has also been instrumental for the development of disruptive and futuristic space technologies for the new decades. Dr. Da is an alumnus of the Department of Physics, St. Xavier's College, Kolkata, and Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics, University of Kolkata. He earned his PhD on the lunar exosphere from Cochin University of Science and Technology, while working as a scientist in the Space Physics Laboratory, Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, ISRO. Dr. Da, I'd like to again extend a warm welcome to you. The screen is yours.
Thank you very much, Shri Praveen and team. I consider it to be an immense honor to have been invited by IISc, IEEE Communication Society, to deliver this public address. And once again, I wish you my best wishes and my gratitude to have invited me in this forum. So shall I start the presentation?
Yes, sir, you should start.
Okay. Thank you very much. Before starting the presentation, let me tell you the meticulous arrangements which you have done by collecting the profiles of the possible audience of this public lecture has made my presentation fine-tuned in order to reach the beginners in the field of research. I have observed that out of all the registered participants for this public lecture, majority of them are students of undergraduate and postgraduate level. Many of them may not have the introduction of this subject of communication, quantum communication through space. Even to be frank with you, I am also a learner in this field. So it is really an opportunity for me to share whatever humble knowledge I have with you. So let's begin. So are you able to see my second slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in the month of March 2021, for the first time in the country, Indian Space Research Organization has successfully demonstrated end-to-end free space quantum communication over a distance of 300 meters. A number of key technologies were developed indigenously to accomplish this major feat, which included the use of indigenously developed NavIC receiver for the time synchronization between transmitter and receiver modules, the special kind of gimbal mechanism for the communication between the receiver and transmitter instead of using bulky large aperture telescopes for the purpose of optical alignment. The free space QKD was demonstrated at the Space Application Center, SAC, Ahmedabad, of the Indian Space Research Organization, between two line of sight buildings within the campus. The experiment was performed at night in order to ensure that there is no interference of the direct sunlight. And the experiment is a major breakthrough towards ISRO's goal of demonstrating satellite-based quantum communication, or SBQC, where ISRO is gearing up to demonstrate the technology between two Indian ground stations. So in this lecture, we will discuss the basics of quantum communication, what makes it so special, and what does it imply to data security. So quantum communication is a scheme which offers unconditional security of data when communicated over the transmission channel. So when we say unconditional, what do we mean? We mean that there is no terms and conditions attached, like if we have no source of, no resource to break the communication, then only it is secure, or the code is secure only if the eavesdropper doesn't have enough time to decode. This kind of conditions to ensure security. Your transmitted data should remain secure no matter what the situation is. So that is unconditional security. Quantum communication is a disruptive technology. Like the electric bulb was not discovered as a result of continuous improvement over candles. Quantum communication is not a result of continuous improvement of conventional digital communication. Quantum communication, as you will appreciate once I proceed with the lecture, is a multidisciplinary subject. It promises you unconditional security of your information. It is a subject that has seen a confluence of fundamentals of physics, especially quantum mechanics, linear and nonlinear optics, material science, communication engineering, to name a few. It is such a subject where you have discussions on fundamental concepts like Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, quantum non-locality, and modern engineering topics like communication engineering protocols, all in the same page. But this subject is so vast that it forms a master course in the technology by itself, with full of advanced mathematics. And in this discussion, instead of going into the mathematics, I will put all my effort to simplify the fundamental concepts of quantum communication without much of a mathematics and technical jargons. This lecture is designed to give you a pretty good qualitative idea about what quantum communication is and how different it is from the conventional communication protocols and systems. Now, during this discussion, I shall present the glimpses of how security was handled before the digital era began. To be precise, I shall cover the major encryption methods used by mankind since the last 2000s of years, and how did the system evolve. And then I shall show how secrecy was addressed in the digital era and what are the problems associated with that. You will find that every time somebody came up with a smart encryption technique, another person came up with a smarter technique to break the encryption system. So the question arises, is there anything that can offer unconditional security? We will see how quantum cryptography and quantum communication handles this issue. So this discussion is about how quantum mechanics promises to protect our well-kept secrets. So stay tuned with the evolution of the subject in this journey. Now we all have secrets. Here I will introduce you with Alice, a college girl, and his boyfriend Bob. As you can guess, they have a well-preserved secret. Alice wants to send a message to Bob. Let's meet tomorrow. And there is a third person. She eavesdrops between them. Alice and Bob want to find a mechanism to ensure that Eve never gets hold of their secret communication. In our discussion, we will consider Alice as the transmitter and Bob the receiver. Now the question is that, can Alice use a robust encryption mechanism to encode her message and send it to Bob? During our discussion, we will use a few terms. The raw message will be referred to as the plain text, and the encrypted message will be called a cryptogram or a ciphertext. So the need for preserving secrets dates back to prehistoric days. Evidences exist in favor of use of cryptosystems even before the birth of Jesus Christ. It was before the digital era, people did not feel the need of the use of zeros and ones to represent the information. It was the time when information is to be communicated in the way we speak or write, that is in words or sentences, in the conventional way of communicating with one another. So there existed two fundamental types of encryption system. First, permutation method, and the second, substitution method. Later, combinations of both techniques were used. So we will quickly see what were those techniques. So in this picture, you can see the SkyTel system, which was used during 400 BC in Sparta. It is basically a permutation technique where the locations of the alphabets in the word or sentence used to be changed. Here you see a cylinder which served at the base to write the message on the strip of a paper or a cloth and wound around it. After unwinding the paper from the cylinder, the letters collectively had no apparent meaning because the letters were permuted in the process. One could read the message correctly only after rewinding the strip of paper around the cylinder of the correct diameter. Now, you may guess this was not a very strong cipher. Breaking it was only a matter of identifying a correct diameter of cylinder. Julius Caesar in Rome started a cipher technique, which is popularly known as the Caesar cipher. If we have to demonstrate this in English using the Roman alphabets, it is just substituting one letter by the other. So in this picture, I have shown that letter A is substituted by the letter D, B by E, and so on. That is, there has been a three character shift in this substitution. So if the original message is attack tomorrow, it will be encoded as something like DWWDFNWRPRUURZ. The breaking the Caesar cipher amounted to guessing correctly the amount of shift of characters in the substitution. Once your guess is correct, you can break the Caesar cipher also. Now, it may sound difficult to break, but it was really accomplished by a person called Al-Kindi. In Al-Kindi's method was simple. It was based on identifying which alphabet was most frequently used in the language. As for example, in English, the letter E is the most used one. Now, if we assume that the information written in that language will also follow a similar statistical distribution, then it was not difficult to correctly guess the amount of shift used in the cipher. So people thought of making the substitution class of ciphers a bit more complicated. What to use the constant value of the shift? Hence, the concept of polyalphabetic ciphers were invented, in which the amount of shift was a variable quantity. In this example, we have shown three values of the shift, that is 7, 14, and 19. It means that for the first letter of the information, use 7 characters of shift. For the second letter, use 14 characters of shift. For the third letter, use 19 characters of shift. And for the fourth letter, you come back to 7, that is 7 characters of shift. And the cycle continues in this way. It was realized by fabricating Albarty's encryption disk containing two dials with the letters written onto them. So one dial could be rotated with respect to the other, and depending on the shift amount required, the dial used to be rotated and substituted value of the letter was written. So that was the mechanism for this variable substitution method of encryption. Now this code was an incremental improvement over the Caesar cipher, as you can follow. And hence this also could be broken. This time it was broken by Charles Babbage himself, the scientist whose name is associated with early computing machines. So Albarty's disk gave rise to rotor machines. It was a step to mechanize the process of mechanical machines. This also, as you can guess, didn't stand the test of time. Then arrived the Enigma 1940 encryption machine, which was extensively used during the Second World War. It had an electromechanical rotor mechanism where scrambled the 26 letters of the alphabet. Note that it was not a predictable shift. It was fundamentally a substitution method, but based on scrambling of the mechanical devices. So perhaps the Enigma 1940 is one of the early examples where the concept of randomness was brought in, which we follow even today. In that machine, if plain text was entered, it is to light up the letters where the encoded ciphertext is to be formed. So the rotor mechanism changed the electrical connections between the keys and the lights with each key press. The rotor settings were the parameters of the encryption process. Now, this philosophy of encryption, what we have discussed so far, were all the pre-digital era. The philosophy of encryption changed with the advent of the digital era. In English, there are 26 alphabets, but in digital world, there are only two, 0 and 1. So when everything started to be represented by zeros and ones, people felt the need of new techniques of encryption. Substitutions and permutations were good for cases with many characters. In digital domain, there are only two characters, and it necessitated having some different kinds of techniques for encryption. Now, one good news was that by then, the Boolean algebra was established. People knew how to add binary numbers, and hence in the digital era, there was a, there was a disruptive change in the arena of cryptography. So we will start our journey from here with the story. Once upon a time, there was a great master who had two main disciples named Jai and Vijay. Jai and Vijay were good friends, and so they were sad when it was the time to part. They prayed to their master, are we going to stay at, we are going to stay at two different distant places. We are not going to be able to see each other daily. Kindly grant us the power to read each other's mind whenever we need to do so. The master agreed. He said, I will teach you how to read each other's mind. He taught Jai and Vijay a special procedure that had to follow to read each other's mind. Jai and Vijay were pretty happy, and they asked the master, is this procedure enough to read each other's mind? The master said, no. What else is needed? Master said, every time you need to read each other's mind, you need to meditate me and let me know your own thoughts. Through meditation, I will send you a magic spell. You have to use that magic spell along with the procedure which I have taught you to read the other person's mind. So let's test it, they have thought. So Jai and Vijay started thinking something. Both of them followed the procedure along with the magic spell given by their master. And soon Jai and Vijay could read each other's mind. And they were pretty happy about it. Now, the question is that, was that a fairy tale? The answer is no, it was not a fairy tale. The special procedure is analogous to what we today call an XOR operation, XOR gate operation. I hope you all remember the XOR operation, which yields a one if and only if there is only single digital one at the input. The magic spell is analogous to the XOR operation between Jai and Vijay's thoughts. Let us see how Vijay reads Jai's thoughts. It is through the operation Jai's thought is equal to Vijay's thought, XOR, magic spell. By the symmetry of the problem, Jai can also read Vijay's thought by a similar technique. Now, we will demonstrate this with an example. So, Jai's thought, let us assume that Jai's thought is 101011 and Vijay's thought is 011001. And let us assume the magic spell is 101011 XOR 011001. So which comes as 110010. This magic spell actually contains the information, the thoughts of both these communicating parties. Okay. Now Vijay's thought is his own thought, XORing with the magical spell, and he gets back Jai's thought. That is how the system works. Now, if I have to summarize, only one equation which I am going to use throughout this lecture is only this one. And perhaps this is the only formula which I will use frequently. And it is simple enough to remember. The relation is used as a fundamental one in the encryption of digital data communicated over a channel. One example of such an this application is one-time pad. And mind you, there is no quantum mechanics involved here. It is simple digital Boolean algebra, which gives you this, and you can see the problem is symmetrical also. Now, in the one-time pad scheme, we have a plain text in the binary and a random number generator that generates a random sequence of binary digits. Now, what we have to do is, if we have plain text of, say, 10 bits, you have to have a random number sequence of 10 bits. That is, we have to cut the length of the random binary sequence to match with the length of the plain text. In this example, we have the binary form of the words attack tomorrow as the plain text, which has 105 bits. So we cut exactly 105 bits of the random binary sequence and use it as the encryption key. Now, there is a famous theorem in information theory called Varnum's theorem. According to Varnum's theorem, if the plain text and the encryption key have the same length of bits, their bitwise XOR operation between them infuse randomness of the encryption key to the message. And thus, the encoded message, which we call the ciphertext, is secure. Its security was proven by the famous information scientist Claude Shannon. And the one-time PAT is one of the widely used fundamental encryption schemes used today in digital communication. Now, coming to the implementation example of the one-time PAT in this picture, we see a typical example of how the one-time PAT is implemented. So you have two communicating parties, Alice and Bob, and what you see, there is a loop which could be an optical fiber. It could be a free space also. Here I have shown an example as an optical fiber. So now Alice has a plain text, which we call small p, 101101. And Alice has an encryption key, which we call KA, 101001. So how did Alice get the encryption key? Alice has an encryption key generator, a random number generator. And the encrypted message is generated by bitwise XORing, P XOR KA, and you get the number. Once you do the XORing, you get 000 and 100. Now Alice sends the encrypted message of the ciphertext over the optical fiber of the free space, and Bob somehow has the same key with him. See, I repeat, Bob somehow has the same key with him. Now, what happens? Bob receives the encrypted message. The message is P XOR KA. And what does Bob do? Bob does bitwise XORing operation on the encrypted key text with the key KA. That is, he does on the ciphertext another XOR operation, and he gets back or retrieves Alice's message P. Now, you might have noticed here, there is a crux of the whole scheme, which is Alice and Bob should share the same key, K. In the terminology of encryption theory, we call it a symmetrical key. Somehow, both of them have to have the same key. Now, in this symmetrical encryption problem where both Alice and Bob should have the same key, I have shown this example with a block diagram. Now you might have started appreciating the problem here. First, how to ensure that Alice and Bob share the same key? Should they meet privately prior to the communication? Even if they do, chances are there that they would run out of the encryption key if they wish to communicate more bits of plain text than the length of the key. As I told, you should have the same length of the bit length as the plain text. So this is basically a key generation and distribution problem. Now here, we have to remember one more thing, that this key cannot be used more than once. And that's why we call it a one-time scheme for security reasons. And thus one has to have ideally a repository of infinitely long key so as to use them without the fear of not depleting the key or using any part of the key. You should not be running short of the key length, and you should not repeat any part of the key. Sometimes meeting privately to agree the keys is not feasible if they're far away or going to communicate for the first time. While generating an encryption key, one has to be conscious about the randomness aspect. In this picture, I have shown examples of keys with different degrees of randomness. An encryption key should not be predictable, and hence it should be perfectly random. Although we know that the random numbers are whatever we generate are not perfect random numbers, what we generate are called pseudo random numbers. So you have seen some examples, examples of a bad key. Everything is zero, there is no one here, so definitely there is a bad key, very much predictable. Second one is a better key, because zeros and ones both are there, but you see there is a repetition involved here, predictable pattern, repetition after a certain bit length is happening. It is a better key. The third one is a good key. It is a random, almost same numbers of zeros and ones. Now the question is how to generate a random key and how to share a good key securely. Now an elegant solution to this problem is public key crypto system, which is used nowadays widely to for financial transactions and to cater to other requirements of data security. The public key crypto system avoids the requirement of the key distribution with a clever use of certain mathematical techniques. It is an asymmetrical encryption system where the encryption key is not the same as the decryption key. So we will have a quick look at what is a public key crypto system and how far does it guarantee security. So before going to describe quantum cryptography, let us understand the basic concept of a public key crypto system. So far we have not entered the realm of quantum mechanics. It is all classical law, and what I'm going to tell is a bare analogy. The public key crypto system avoids the key distribution problem with a mathematical trick, as I told you. So without introducing the mathematical approach, we can draw an analogy to understand the public key crypto system qualitatively. So let us assume that there is a safe box with two keyholes and two keys. One of them is the locking key, while the other is the unlocking key. Thus, two keys have completely different roles. We call the locking key the public key, which is used to lock the box, and which we have shown here in blue color. The other key, which is the unlocking key, is the private key, and in this slide we have shown it in the red color. Let us assume that we distribute such boxes to you, and all the boxes are in open condition. Each box has an attached public key. Suppose you wish to send a message to me. You write a message, then put it inside and lock it with the public key attached with the box. Now, once the box is locked, you cannot unlock the box with that key. Now the box arrives my location, and I have with me my private key, at which always remains with me. With the private key, I will unlock the box and get the message. This scheme is basically a mathematical setup and therefore has a lot of flexibilities. The keys mentioned in this analogy are some mathematical parameters or numbers, and the box is a mathematical system. The flexibility is such that the mathematical algorithm allows to interchange the roles of the public and private keys. That is, one can unlock with a public key and lock with a private key. This type of scheme can be used for the purpose of authentication. For authentication, you can write a message, put it in a box, lock it with your private key, and this box can be unlocked with your public key. Now you put that box into my box and lock it with my public key and send it to me. So I unlock the box with my private key and find the second box inside it. I use the public key to sender to unlock the second box. Sounds complicated. We will not get into that. Not required also, but this is how the authentication is done. Now this type of scheme is followed in the RSA public crypto system, wherein two mathematical parameters play the roles of private key and the public key. Although this system is elegant and flexible, it may not be unconditionally secure. The question is that, is it possible to figure out my private key from my public key? I repeat, is it possible to figure out my private key from my public key? If it is possible, then there is a danger. Both the public and private keys are generated from the same mathematical system, and hence they are not independent of each other. If there is a mechanism to guess what is my private key from my public key, the problem starts from there. The RSA public crypto system is depicted in this block diagram. As mentioned, the private and public keys are generated from the same mathematical system. And Alice wants to send the message to Bob, and Bob's public key is available in the public key directory, which Alice can access. Bob's private key, however, remains with Bob, and it is not available with Alice. Alice encrypts her message with Bob's public key and transmits the encrypted message through the public channel. Bob is supposed to decrypt the encrypted message with his public key. Alice is confident that no eavesdropper can decrypt the message in between, since it is difficult to guess the private key of Bob. Now the question is it really difficult to derive Bob's private key from his public key? The entire setup is a mathematical factor with a parameter n. You see here, there is a mathematical parameter n. So we will avoid the detailed mathematical description of the RSA ecosystem. You can very well refer to the internet, or the different tutorials are there which will cover these aspects. All that I want to convey to you is this n is a product of two prime numbers, small p and small q. If we call the message as capital P and the public key as small e and the private key as small d, then the encryption is done with the formula C equal to capital P small e modulo n. Note that the information that are available publicly are e, small e is available publicly, small n is available publicly, and C is also available publicly because you are sending it over a public channel. Now the decryption is done with the formula capital P equal to capital C small d modulo of n. Mathematically, one can show, again, I am not going to go to that details of mathematics, but one can show that it is possible to derive the private key, that is small d, from the public key, small e, if it is possible to factorize n. That is, if there is a mechanism to factorize n, you can get small p and small q from n. And thus the code breaking problem reduces to a simple factorization problem. I'm telling simple, but it is not simple, but it is really boiling down to a factorization problem. If you can factorize the number n, you will get access to the private key d from the public key e. Now, breaking the RSA ecosystem is as difficult to factorize a large number. Computer scientists classify algorithms in complexity classes. It depends on how does the resource requirement increase when one increases the scale of the problem. So you can think of the resources as the computational power and computational time. For example, if you wish to multiply two numbers and keep on increasing the number of digits while noting down the execution time in each step, you will find a polynomial increase in the execution time with the scaling of the problem. If the increase in resource requirement increases exponentially with the scale of the problem, the computer scientists will call them complex algorithms. Factorization is such an example. But since the resource requirement grows exponentially with the size of the number to be factorized, this is used as the underlying feature in the RSA ecosystem, or in other words, the RSA ecosystem depends on the complexity of the factorization problem. Now, if you discover a technique to solve the factorization problem in a polynomial time, now it is taking exponential time, you devise a technique so that it is solvable in polynomial time. So what is going to happen? The RSA ecosystem will no longer be secure. All that we require for that are fast hardware, a clever algorithm, and some time. We know that quantum factoring algorithm, you must have listened to different lectures in this workshop in the last 2 days, and there's a quantum factoring algorithm running on a quantum computer, which can solve the factorization problems in polynomial time. So it is only a matter of time when quantum algorithm can interfere with the classical public repo systems and rupture the security. Now, in a nutshell, the RSC crypto system, which is based on the mathematical complexity of the factoring large numbers, is vulnerable to quantum computers. In 2010, a 768-bit number was factorized in 1500 CPU years. To be precise, 2 years of real time were required using parallel computing with thousands of computers to factorize the number. A typical RSA crypto system is about 1024 or 2056 or 4096 bits long, which can be factored in a few hours with classical parallel computing system with a few thousands of computers in a parallel computing mode. Now here comes something wonderful. Peter Shor's quantum factoring algorithm, which provides a tool to factor large numbers in polynomial time. Quantum computers scientists are working on how can a standard crypto system like RSA can be cracked in a few hours of time. And if that is possible, it will disrupt the fields of economics, strategic sector, and similar other fields where data encryption underpins the growth of a country. That is why it is important to invest on a crypto system which is future-proof. In other words, the holy grail of crypto systems is to achieve a framework which will be eternally invincible and continue to provide unconditional security, as I have mentioned at the beginning of my lecture. A system can be eternally invincible if it is based on something that does not change with time, something like the laws of nature. As for example, if you build a crypto system that relies on how strong a physical wall is made, it depends on the condition that no system can impart sufficient energy to break the wall. Such a crypto system, as you can guess, cannot be eternal, as it can be broken with sufficient energy, if not today, but definitely by tomorrow's technology. On the other hand, if you build a crypto system based on the laws of nature, the laws of physics, say, the second law of thermodynamics, which is eternally invisible. Otherwise, the conservation laws of nature will be at stake. So it is here where quantum cryptography offers its potential as an unconditionally secured crypto system. Now, these expectations from a future-proof crypto system are that it should remain immune to future advancements of computer technology or computation power. Also, the present encrypted data cannot be broken after a few years with more time and better computation power. So you save the data today, and later on when your computation technology is matured, you break. So that should also not be possible. For the reasons we already discussed, the crypto systems that depend on the complexities of the mathematical algorithms are not going to fit the bill. They're not future-proof. And here the quantum cryptography finds a solution. According to the laws of quantum mechanics, any measurement disturbs the system. So it is impossible to measure and hence clone the complete quantum state with absolute accuracy, which is an outcome of the famous Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, leading to the no cloning theorem. And another aspect of the quantum correlation, another aspect of this thing is quantum correlation to protect information, which we call quantum entanglement. Now, the subject of quantum communication is indebted to these two concepts, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle leading to the no cloning theorem, and the concept of quantum non-locality and quantum entanglement, and which we will discuss in the subsequent part of the lecture. Now, there are several ways to generate entangled photons. To understand the one which we use for quantum key distribution, we have to go back to the optics course once again, and perhaps to a certain extent of material science. It is all about interaction of light with matter. Here we have to revisit the term polarization, which we have studied in physics. Polarization perhaps is one of the most frequently used terms, that too in different senses. In optics, polarization tells about how the electric field vector of the electromagnetic radiation is aligned. In material science, the term is used in a different sense. It is used to quantify the disturbance of the charge distribution in an atom due to an external electric field. This term is also used in politics. However, that is beyond the scope of this discussion. Now, let us suppose you have a special kind of material, the property of which changes with the increase of the intensity of light incident on it. In terms of the electric field associated with the electromagnetic radiation, the susceptibility of the material dictates how efficiently will the atoms inside the material will be polarized because of the electric field of the incident light. So mathematically, we write polarization with the equation P is equal to chi into E, epsilon chi E, where epsilon is the permittivity of the material, chi is the susceptibility, and E the electric field. Now, what happens is the following. In our special kind of material that we use in this kind of communication, the susceptibility X, I mean chi, has got higher order terms. That is, the relation between P and E, the polarization and E, the electric field is P equal to chi E plus chi 2 E squared plus chi 3 E cube. It is a polynomial containing higher order terms. So not only the term linear term E comes, also the terms containing E squared comes, and the higher order terms also might come, but maybe at lower amplitude. Now, if E is strong, the electric field is strong, the second order term of the susceptibility starts contributing, and the relation between the polarizability and electric field, they are no longer linear. So we call such materials nonlinear crystals. A laser beam incident on a nonlinear crystal can exhibit such interesting phenomena due to this different types of interesting phenomena due to this nonlinear effect. We will come to that discussion soon. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible, but the slide hasn't changed. Still the polarization slide.
It is still the polarization slide, is it not?
Yes.
Okay. So, just a minute. So what I will do is, the slide has not changed. I will go back to the slide manually. So can you see the slide now?
Yes.
Yeah. So in conventional computation, we embed the digital information on the amplitude, frequency, or the phase of a carrier wave, which are called amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, and phase modulation. These techniques don't offer absolute security as a part of the wave energy can be taken away by the eavesdropper for hacking without the knowledge of the communicating parties. So in quantum communication, on the other hand, we exploit the quantum properties of light and matter, which get disturbed upon being attempted or being eavesdropped, thereby altering the alerting the communicating parties. Often photons are used to encode this information. The beauty of using photons in communication is that they're amenable to electromagnetic interference. Often we encrypt the binary zeros and ones in the polarization state of the photon. As for example, in the picture, a linearly polarized light is shown, where the vertical polarization represents a digital one, while the horizontal polarization represents a digital zero. So although we may have the other possible choices as well. So at this juncture, you may find it a bit confusing to use the terms polarization and photons, since polarization has got something to do with the wave nature of light, while photons depict the particle nature. So before going to the further details, it is important to reconcile these two ideas and be convinced that a photon, single photon, has its definite direction of polarization. So if you look upon light as an electromagnetic wave comprising orthogonal electric and magnetic fields, the polarization direction is given by the direction of its electric field vector. For a typical light source, you have numerous trains of light waves emanated. For each light wave train, which we call the wave train, there is a definite direction of polarization. But since all the wave trains emanated from a light source are uncorrelated, they enjoy the freedom of individual to individually choose their polarization directions, and hence we call the overall stream of light unpolarized. Now let us now concentrate on a particular wave train with a specific direction of polarization. The wave train comes with a finite length, which we call the coherence length. Within this coherence length, the wave train maintains the phase continuity, and hence, you know, coherence and polarization becomes meaningful. We can look such a wave train as a wave packet or something discrete as an entity, which we may call a photon. And thus, a photon has its polarization. And we will henceforth use the term polarization of a photon. So in optics, there are, you know, special kinds of optical components like polarizers. Here, what I am showing you is plain polarized light with intensity I0, which is coming to a polarizer. And you see that the polarizer angle is making an angle phi with respect to the angle of the electric field vector. So what is happening, if you go on changing the angle of phi between 0, 90 degree, minus 45 degree, and plus 45 degree, you get different amounts of light coming out of the polarizer. So when they're perfectly aligned, phi is 0, light comes out completely. When it is 90 degree, light is completely blocked. And for the other two cases, the light intensity gets halved. Okay, and I don't know why this slide is getting stuck. Just a minute. Okay, so those who remember the coordinate geometry must remember the concept of a basis. You know, a basis is just a coordinate system with respect to which you describe a curve or a physical phenomenon. The same person lying on bed may be described, you know, at an angle of 0 degree with respect to a basis, while another basis may describe him to be at 45 degrees. So in this picture, what I have shown is I have shown two bases. On the left hand side, I have shown what we refer to as orthogonal basis, and using the orthogonal basis, we are able to define two unambiguous polarization states of the photons. That is, we call them vertical and horizontal, V and H. Since we are speaking about individual or single photons, any direction other than vertical and horizontal will bring ambiguity in its description, and randomness will creep in. Similarly, with the diagonal basis, we are able to define unambiguously two other photonic polarization states, and we call them plus 45 degree and minus 45 degree. So in a nutshell, we say that we can prepare the horizontal and vertical polarization states with the orthogonal basis, and the plus minus 45 degree polarization states with the diagonal basis. In our journey, we will use the term preparation of the polarization of state quite often, and this is what it really means. So after having prepared a photon in the given polarization state, now we will see the interesting outcomes of measuring it. What happens when you prepare them using the orthogonal basis and measure them using the same basis? It is very simple. Then what will happen is, if you measure them with the proper basis, you get the correct result. But what happens when you measure them with the wrong basis? From the previous discussions, you might have guessed by now what would happen if you measured the photon polarization on the wrong basis. You will land up in a probabilistic scenario. And hence, you cannot get an unambiguous answer about the state of polarization of the photon. Remember, in all our discussions, we are considering single photons unless we specify otherwise. And let us assume that we have prepared our four photons with four different states of polarization, V, H, minus, and plus. Here, minus will mean minus 45 degree, and plus would mean plus 45 degree. So obviously, the V and H states of polarization were prepared using the orthogonal basis, and the other two were prepared using the diagonal basis. Now, having them prepared, it is the time to measure them at different bases. First, we send the vertical state photon. It is sent through the orthogonal basis measurement system. A measurement basis is also a polarizer, which we often in the language of optics call an analyzer. When we say that we are making an orthogonal basis measurement, what we mean is that we are placing an analyzer in the path of the photon in a way such that the polarization axis of the analyzer is either vertical or horizontal with respect to the common reference frame, say the reference frame of the laboratory. In this case, the particle photon will either emerge out completely or blocked completely. Nothing in between is possible. So there will be no ambiguity of recognizing a particle photon as a particle photon. Once we know the state of the incoming photon and the type of the basis which we are using for the measurement. The same logic holds for horizontal photon when measured using an orthogonal basis. Now take the case of a plus or minus photon, which is made to pass through an orthogonal basis measurement system. As discussed previously, the result will be ambiguous because you're using a wrong basis and you cannot definitively infer back the original polarization state of a photon from the measurement results. Same thing would happen if you send the V or H photon for measurement through the orthogonal basis system. From the probabilistic nature of the outcome, we cannot infer unambiguously whether the original photon was a V or was an H. To sum up, you will get unambiguous result if you prepare and measure the photons in the same basis. And uncertainties creep in when the photons are measured using the different basis in which they are prepared. So whatever we have discussed in the previous slide can be summarized in this picture in the form of a table. So as evident, you will get definitive results if you prepare and measure the photons using the same basis, and there will be uncertainties which will be crept in when the photons are measured in one basis, are prepared in one basis and measured with some other basis. So it will depict in the form of randomness. So let us summarize the lessons which we have learned on the polarization examples using single photons. That if the signals are non-orthogonal, that is, there exists a possibility to measure them with an inappropriate basis, the results of their measurement cannot be ascertained. And if the signals are orthogonal, the result of their measurement is always certain. We have shown as examples A, B, and C in this slide. Now, on the lighter side, let us imagine a situation where a Chinese chef asks a Chinese guest, what would you would love to eat? And the Chinese guest responds, and the chef does not have any difficulty to understand what he means. He wanted to have some fish, and the same thing happens when you prepare and measure the photons with the same basis. In contrary, let us assume that a situation where the same Chinese chef asks the same question to an Indian guest. The Indian guest represents some wrong basis, and he responds obviously arbitrarily because he doesn't understand the question, and the chef remains clueless about what he says. So you may compare this situation where the photons are prepared and measured with a different basis. And let us extend this situation to a point where a group of people in a room, some of whom are Indian and some of whom are Chinese. So an Indian man sings them a song and them asks in Hindi, "Friends, how did you like my song? How did you like it?" The Indian audience understood the question and responded correctly, while the Chinese audience was clueless. The Indian singer also remains clueless about what the Chinese audience is. The same thing happens for the other case also, when you replace Indian by the Chinese. Now, let us build up the story from here in the context of quantum communication as a first step, of course, to generate and distribute the secret key. In the next step, the key will be used for encrypting the message. In the picture has got nothing to do with quantum communication. That is, Alice wants to prepare some photons in the horizontal and vertical polarizations representing zeros and ones. And he can send, and Bob can understand zeros and ones. So now, it is a very simple case. The problem is the case very much secured? The answer is no, the case is not secured. It is not a simple, secured case of communication. Because now the eavesdropper comes to the picture, and eavesdropper will, with the correct knowledge of the basis, can intercept the transmission from Alice and read the polarization states of the photons correctly and retransmit the photons. And the Bob will remain ignorant of the fact that the information has been compromised. Even if the eavesdropper do not have the knowledge of the basis used for the communication, there remains a 50% probability that she will use the correct basis and jeopardize the security. To circumvent this problem, Alice and Bob adds more sophistication to their communication protocol. Instead of using only one basis, they agree to use two bases, orthogonal and diagonal bases in their key distribution scheme. And let us assume that Alice managed to generate a random keys with 12 bits, as I have shown, using a random key generator 1A, as shown in the first row of the table. And her job is to encode the bits in the random key into polarization state of the photons. And this time she has four options, H, V, plus, and minus. And she assigns V for plus polarization and V and plus polarization states to digital 1, and H and minus polarization states to digital 0. And Alice has another random number generator called 2A, A for Alice, which with which she assigns the polarization states to zeros and ones. That is, if Alice has to encode a digital 0, should choose you'd use the random number generator 2A to decide whether to use H or minus state of the polarization to represent the zero. If she has to encode a digital 1, the random number generator 2A decides whether to use V or plus to represent the state. So the first random number generator 1A is to generate the random key, while the second one is used to choose the basis to encode the each of the bits. Now Alice prepares and transmits the photons as shown in the second row. The channel through which she sends the polarization of the photons is often referred to as the quantum channel. It is nothing exotic, as quantum channel could be a simple optical fiber even or even the free space. The requirement is that the channel would not disturb the polarization states of the photons. That makes it quantum. Those who are familiar with optics, you are familiar with the phenomenon of the birefringence. This type of event should not happen, which can disturb the polarization. Bob, on the other hand, measures the polarization states of the photons transmitted by Alice. This time, however, he does not have any idea on which basis he needs to use to measure the polarization for a given photon. He uses a random number generator 1B, again B for Bob, to select the basis to measure each polarization state. And obviously, he stands 50% probability to use wrong basis to measure a given photon. And the basis Bob selects to measure the photons are listed in the third row of the table. Finally, the fourth row of his measurement lists the measurement results. But notice that in the fourth row, a few measurements are written in red color. Those are the measurements for which Bob has used the wrong basis. We see that there are five such occurrences where Bob chooses the wrong basis. And in these five occurrences, the measured values of the digital state are not necessarily wrong in all cases. Bob measured the 8 and 10 bits correctly, but only by chance. This happens due to the randomness of the result and once the wrong basis is used to measure the polarization state. And poor Bob, however, has no ways to know for which the basis he chose, it was wrong. So Bob also notes down which soever basis he has used to measure each photon in a notebook. And at this juncture, Alice comes to her rescue. She says, okay, well, see, I will read out one by one which basis I have used to prepare the photons, and you just see your list, whatever basis you have used, and discard where we don't agree. Okay, keep only the results where our basis matched. So this process is called the basis reconciliation process. This happens only over the classical channel. A classical channel could only be conventional communication channel, which you can think of. It could be a optical fiber or any channel, and it could be a free space also. In this basis reconciliation, Alice and Bob discard the five cases for which the wrong basis were used to measure. And this is shown in the fifth row of the table. Now I have noticed that it is already 5 o'clock, but I will take only some 10 to 12 minutes to complete the basic parts of the presentation. I will cut short the parts which are too much obvious. You please bear with me for some 10, 12 more minutes. Discarding the digital states corresponding to the wrong measurements, Alice and Bob are left with some 7 bits, 12 minus 5, 7 bits. These bits constitute what we refer to as the shifted key. And note that Alice has started with 12 bits, but after the process of basis reconciliation, she is left only with 7 bits. Now, why this happened? Because the usage of the wrong basis by Bob for a certain cases. Had Bob made no mistake, that is, had Bob used the identical basis as Alice, there would have been no mistake, and the door key and the secret key would have had the same number of bits. In fact, they would have been identical. But now that if there is more, one more element making the mistake in the chain, that one more element can be an eavesdropper. Let us assume that there is an eavesdropper in the chain equipped with two bases. She intercepts the transmission from Alice and tries to measure the polarization states of the photons using two bases arbitrarily. And in this process, she is bound to make 50% mistake on average, as Bob did in our, as I discussed previously. Without being aware of the mistakes she made in our measurement, the eavesdropper regenerates the photons according to the her faulty measurement and retransmits to Bob. And Bob again will commit his quota of mistakes. So what happens finally when they check for the basis reconciliation? This double source of mistake manifests as enhanced quantum bit error rate. Thus, if the quantum bit error rate is beyond a given threshold, the presence of an eavesdropper is inferred and the key generation is aborted. And thus, the randomness is measured of the measured values due to the use of the wrong basis, which is basically Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, helps to sense the presence of the eavesdropper. And you may draw an analogy of this game with the Chinese whisper game. I whisper a word into your ear and there is a chance of you to listen it longly, and you pass it on to the third person and there is a chance to make further mistake and the mistake accumulates. So this is how the thing happens. And what you have learned is just the BB84 protocol. So I will not discuss all the steps, but all that I can tell you is in this BB84 protocol itself, there are different steps which ensures that your key has to be secret. The key which you are sharing between the communicating parties should be secret, and they have to be identical. And for this, you have different steps. So I will not go to the different steps. I will go to directly the concept of the space-based quantum communication. See, when you use optical fibers, it is having a distance limitation. Typically, it is limited to a distance of a few hundreds of kilometers, which can be increased with the extended nodes and repeaters. And the attenuation of this with the telecom wavelengths is in the order of 0.2 decibel per kilometer at 150 nanometer. Now, the exponentially varying, this attenuation of the optical fiber limits this application over long distances. And when you have to go to other long distances, you have to go to satellites, which can easily cater to distances of 10 to the power 3 kilometers. And this is very much important, because the attenuation is not exponentially varying, it is a polynomial variation. And this is very much necessary for the security of the space assets. So this picture shows a schematic of the satellite-based quantum communication in which we have shown a simple BB84-based satellite-based quantum communication. So in this configuration, what happens, a single photon source is located at the space segment. The ground segment comprises two optical ground stations, Alice and Bob. And Alice wants to send a message to Bob using the SBQC, and the satellite is in the Earth, low Earth orbit. And the same thing happens, that the satellite generates two keys, MA and MB, are sent to the respective ground stations, and Alice encrypts it message by performing an XOR, and sends the encrypted message ciphertext over the classical channel. Satellite also sends this MA XOR MB to encrypt it to the Alice and Bob, and Bob receives. And that's how, with these repeated XOR operations, they can communicate with each other, and Bob receives the message which is sent by Alice. But that is a very, very simple case. But now, what happens when you're having an eavesdropper? Happens when there is another scheme where you're having a source on the ground. Maybe I will skip this for the sake of time. So the problem with BB84 protocol, which I have discussed, is the following. You have to use single photons, but you can never have a single photon in a practical hardware. You always end up with multiple photons, maybe a bunch of a few photons in each pulse of the laser beam. And so there is something called photon number splitting attack. And the communicating parties will not know even if splits up a part of the photons and can read. So there are techniques to counter this kind of an attack by use of an attenuator by which the signal is attenuated, what we call is a weak coherent pulses, wherein you have an average photon of 0.1 to 0.2 photons per pulse. And therein you get only a simple cases where, a few cases where you are having, you know, single photons, and having more photons per pulse is very less probable. And there is another technique called the decoy-state BB84 protocol, where is you change that average number of photons per pulse. The average number of photons you can vary, and by this you can detect the techniques, detect the possible eavesdropping by an eavesdropper. So there are a few problems associated with the BB84 protocol. One is the randomness of the key. You know, the every random number generated is not perfect, and there is a repetition. And if there is a technique to understand the repeatability of the random number, it does not remain a random number source. And here the quantum entanglement phenomena comes handy. So in the quantum entanglement phenomena, there is no dependence on the perfect single photon generation of the source, or no dependence on the perfection of random number generators by the use of quantum entanglement or quantum non-locality phenomena. So in the quantum non-entanglement phenomena, it is a quantum phenomena where two particles behave as a single system, which we call quantum correlation. And that is irrespective of their physical separation, which we call quantum non-locality. And if any one of the two particles which are quantum mechanically entangled are disturbed or measured, the other comes to know that instantaneously. And this phenomenon is known to have no classical analog. So what happens, without going to much of the details, if you're having a nonlinear crystal here, and if you're having a laser beam, a pump beam, as we call, you get two beams. So a single pump beam gives rise to two beams. One beam we call a signal beam, another one is idler beam. And these two beams, you know, they intersect at two points. And at the two points, if you have a mechanism to bring out photons, maybe with the coupling of an optical fiber, there is no way of telling that whether the photon has come from the signal beam or from the idler beam. Now, the beauty of the mechanism is, out of this signal and idler beam, one is horizontally polarized and the other one is vertically polarized. Okay, now when you are getting the single photon from here, and it could have come either from the signal or from the idler beam, it is in a mixed state of the horizontal and vertical. And the two photons which you can derive from these two points, the intersecting points, they act as entangled photons. Now, with this background, coming back to the polarization discussion, we know that polarization is an intrinsic property of the photons and represents the direction of the oscillation of the electric field vector. Now the question is, we can measure the polarization of a photon with respect to an arbitrary angle, and we can use a specific direction of choice. So let us devise an experiment by which a polarization measurement can happen and yield a result of either units of plus one or minus one. Now here, you may ask a question that if you're making a measurement with an entangled source here, which is sending two photons, now the question is, do the photons have any predetermined values, or they assume values as and when they're measured? Now it can be tested with the source of entangled photons, where we will measure the polarization states using these two machines. So Alice and Bob decides to measure the polarization of the photons using the two different directions. Alice measures the polarization in direction A1 and A2, while Bob measures in B1 and B2. Now for each incoming photon, Alice randomly chooses either A1 or A2, and Bob randomly chooses between B1 and B2. And their outcome could be plus one or minus one. Now here, John Bell proposed a random variable as a test statistics, which is given by S equal to A1 into B1 plus B2 plus A2 into B1 minus B2, which we can call as the Bell's parameter. And for all combinations of A1 and A2, B1 and B2, one of the terms is zero, which you can verify, while the other will always be plus minus two. So hence the Bell's parameter is either plus two or minus two in all cases. You can verify from the table. Now what happens if you do this experiment statistically for a train of photons? you will always get these values of S either plus 2 or minus 2. And on an average, if you get the average value of S, it should always be between plus 2 and minus 2, and which is known as the Bell's inequality. You cannot imagine something to get beyond this. Now, if it so happens that you are not getting something between plus 2 and minus 2, you're getting something beyond this limit. The modulus of S is more than 2. Can something like this happens? And if something like this happens, it is definitely counterintuitive, and which means that there is a bit of conspiracy between these two photons, which are deciding that, okay, we will not have predetermined values, we will get measured, and we will show up in a particular way, a conspired way. Okay, so in that case only this thing can happen, the Bell's inequality can be violated. Now the question is, does it really happen? And does Bell inequality get violated? If it gets violated, then what will it mean? It will mean that the photons do not carry any value of polarization until they're measured. And if the values do not exist prior to the measurements, they were not available to anybody, including eavesdroppers. And hence, the testing of the violation of Bell's inequality is a testing of eavesdropping itself. So coming to the fag end of my presentation, I'm running short of time. There is a problem in changing the slides as well. So there has been an experiment by Alan Aspect and his team between 1980s and 82, in which they have demonstrated the violation of Bell's inequality. And this experiment validated the phenomenon of quantum entanglement. And this experiment has led to numerous other experiments which corroborated Bell's findings. And this technique of entanglement, which was validated by these violations of Bell's inequality, is used in the entangled photon mode of satellite-based quantum communication. So what happens is, there are multiple configurations in this one, which I'm showing here, is where the entangled photon sits in the satellite, which we call the space segment. And there are two optical ground stations that form the ground segment. And in the ideal case, we will assume that there is no eavesdropper. And in general, this kind of the QKD system, the entangled photon pairs are shared between the two optical ground stations. So one photon goes to one ground station and the other one goes to the other. And then the same XOR operation is used for the encoding and decoding of the plain text message. And the classical channel transmits the XOR of the plain text message of the quantum key, while at the receiver, one more XOR operation will reveal the plain text. Now what happens in the real case, the atmosphere comes to the picture and the eavesdropper comes to the picture. Atmosphere poses problem in the form of turbulence, scattering of the molecules and aerosols, absorption by molecules and aerosols, and they all can be treated as the case of an eavesdropper. And so mathematically what happens, that the keys which are interpreted by the ground stations may not be the same. It could be K1 and K2. And there is a process of post-processing which is beyond the scope of this lecture. It is like this: if you're having a post-processing, the K1 and K2, both when they undergo the process of post-processing, you generate a common key, which we call KF. The process which we go through is the process of basis reconciliation, getting sifted key, key reconciliation, bit sampling, error detection, Q-bar check, and getting the reconciled key, privacy amplification, you get the final key, KF. And with this key, you do the communication with the same example of the XORing, which I have discussed in the previous slide. And in the ground segment and the space segment, you have a set of hardware like the laser source, spontaneous parametric down conversion scheme, the crystal system for the entanglement, optical system, electronics, positioning, acquisition, and the tracking system. They are the systems which sit in the space segment. And in the ground segment, you have the tracking system, receiver, transmitter. We have to remember that although we have shown the Alice is the transmitter and Bob is the receiver, in reality the communication is a duplex communication, and Alice can transmit also, Alice can receive the communication also, and same thing happens with the Bob. And the technologies which are involved in the satellite-based quantum communication involve, you know, optics, nonlinear optics, laser technology, photo detectors, controlled and timing electronics, which you have to demonstrate in the laboratory. And coming to the satellite-based part, the involvement of satellite involves the position acquisition tracking system, the optical ground stations, classical data communication systems, payload development, and the mission operation. Coming to the end. So the choosing the ground stations, the criteria are that the ground station has to be high altitude, preferably greater than 1 kilometer for the mean sea level to minimize the effects of the atmosphere, less cloud coverage and fog over a year, less atmospheric turbulence, less aerosol optical depth, and preferably along the same longitude if you have to use a polar orbiter satellite for the demonstration. To summarize, we have discussed about the quantum communication, the key generation and distribution in the quantum way, and rest are all classical, and which are based on the laws of nature and hence future-proof. They don't depend on the mathematical complexities. Single photon-based methods are discussed, which are based on the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Entanglement-based methods are there, which is based on the quantum non-locality principles. And optical fiber could be the mechanism, could be the medium of the communication, but it is limited to the distance of 100 to 200 kilometers. For the longer distances, you need satellites, especially for quantum communication over the continental distances and for interplanetary quantum key distributions. And certain things which I could not cover in the presentation, which are beyond the scope of this, is there have been different protocols of quantum communication, like BB84 is already discussed, B94, E91, BBM94 quantum communication. The laboratory setup for the quantum communication I did not discuss here. And there are different configurations of quantum key distribution using satellites. And there are, you know, discussions on inter-satellite quantum distribution and quantum satellite constellation. So thank you for your kind attention. And very sorry, I have extended the time here. So very sorry, and thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tirtha Pratamda, for the wonderful talk. So due to shortage of time, we'll just take one or two questions from the collected questions.
Okay.
First question, why do we need satellite-based quantum communication over optical fiber on the ground? What advantage does it hold?
Yeah, as I told, this is mainly because of the attenuation caused by the optical fiber, which is typically 0.2 decibel per kilometer in the telecom wavelengths, and the signal decreases exponentially. On the other hand, in the free space communication, the signal strength falls because of the beam divergence, which is non-exponential. And for covering intercontinental distances, as well as to establish the interplanetary quantum communication network, you need the satellite-based techniques. But however, you have to remember that for that integrated network, you have to, you know, have a combination of satellite-based quantum communication along with that optical fiber-based network for the sake of continuity and integratedness of the system.
One final question. With regard to the interplanetary communications, what are the steps to develop deep space quantum communications, for example, between Earth and Mars? How simple is it, or how complicated does it get?
Okay, it is a complicated process because when you are communicating between Earth and Mars, so the first step is to demonstrate the quantum communication between two ground stations on Earth itself using the satellite as a trusted node, as an obvious choice. For a deep space quantum communication like Earth and Mars, as you told, we need a constellation of satellites that can relay the quantum information. And here, the quantum repeater technology is one of the fronts that needs maturity. And you know, for this kind of technology, you have to master the technologies of entanglement swapping and entanglement purification sort of methods. For Earth-Mars communication, we may use, again, a wild thought, Moon as an intermediate station. And which sounds, I understand, highly futuristic, but it is permissible by the laws of physics. And the field that needs to be matured in the achieve this thing is, you know, this satellite constellation and the process of quantum relay, and of course, not last but not the least, quantum memory devices. So that is the short answer to this question.
Okay, sir. Thank you, though.